Hi, my name is Edward, and I will be your LSAT teacher today. I received a 170 score on the LSAT in December last year, which was the first time I ever took it. I'd studied for 2.5 months beforehand, which goes to show if you do things right, even with a short window of study, you can get a great score. Now, first things first, my spirit animal is a Tyrannosaurus Rex. So, feel free to call me T-Ed. Now, before I go on to this question which I've prepared for you guys, I will tell you my three tips which you can remember to get the best LSAT score possible. Now, firstly, give yourself a lot of time. If you don't have that many weeks to study in, set aside at least 6 hours a day where you can... buckle down and do your LSAT study, or even just rest and think about LSAT where you don't have any other commitments. Secondly, do as many practice tests as possible. Practice tests are real LSAT questions from the past. They're the only way you'll get really familiar with the same material that the LSAT writers use to create the next LSAT which you're going to take. And thirdly, time yourself. If you time yourself, you'll be able to help yourself increase your speed. Just like an athlete, you'll get a higher score every time you practice. Firstly, you get to know the questions. Secondly, you do the questions faster, and then you get more confident, so you don't stumble as much. So give yourself a lot of time, do practice tests, and time yourself doing practice tests. If you do that over and over again, you can't help but succeed. All right, so let's have a look at this question that I've prepared. I see you have a copy there in front of you. The average length of stay for patients, yada, yada, yada. Okay, when you look at an LSAT question on a real LSAT or a practice test, what's the first thing you should look at? Yeah, okay. The question stem. Why? Because it's going to tell us what type of question it is. This type of question is, the reasoning in the argument is most vulnerable to criticism on the grounds that the argument... Okay, most vulnerable to criticism, that means it's a flaw. We're looking for a flaw. This is a flaw type question, so I'm going to write a little F next to there. So every time I look back at the question, I know that I'm looking for the flaw. If you do this, maybe 1 out of 20, 1 out of 50 times, you'll catch yourself from picking a trap answer, which is designed for people that forgot the question stem. Okay, so let's look at the actual... context text. Alright, what have we look? The average length of stay, okay, average, we'll come back to that, average length of stay, for patients at Edgewater Hospital is 4 days compared to 6 days at University Hospital. Okay, well that's a premise. Since studies show that recovery rates at the two hospitals are similar for patients with similar illnesses, University Hospital could decrease its average length of stay without affecting quality of care. Okay, well, since is before a premise. Okay, so this is a premise. It's giving us more information, and this is the conclusion. They could decrease the average length of stay. Okay, that's the conclusion. Now, it's not a very good conclusion. Even given these two premises are true, this is a pretty shoddy conclusion, as we should expect, because we're looking for a flaw. So we're looking for the problem that happened between the facts in these premises and the argument's conclusion in right here. So let's look at this first premise. The average length of stay, okay, so what does average mean? Mean? Yeah, mean. So the mean, right? The mean is all of the numbers added to each other, divided by the number of numbers, okay? So, let's say at Edgewater Hospital, the average is 4, as it says. University Hospital, the average length of stay is 6 days. Okay, now, this average is taken from the scatter of numbers, which we don't know. We don't know, you know, how many people stay for 1 day, how many people stay for 100 days, we just don't know. Okay, university, 6. So how many people stay for these, we still don't know. We still don't know how long people stay for. We just know that the average stay is 6. We don't even know how many patients there are or what they're going in for. But that's okay. We've got that. So the argument writer says this. Since studies show the recovery rates of the two hospitals are similar, okay, not length of stay, but recovery rates are similar for patients with similar illnesses, okay? So if you scrape your knee at one place, you stay for 2 days. You scrape your knee at another place, you stay for 2 days as well, okay? Well, that's how long it takes to recover. So you stay there, it takes you 2 days to recover. Stay there, it takes you 2 days to recover. So University Hospital could decrease its average length of stay without affecting quality of care. So I guess what they're assuming is that University Hospital, because the average is different, they must hold people for 2 days longer than they should be. Now, there's no information to suggest that. They've simply said, okay, they've taken that to say that the two hospitals are exactly the same, and therefore they should kick people out quicker. So it's a bad argument. And we're going to find the flaw here by eliminating 4 incorrect answer choices and choosing 1 correct answer choice once we've eliminated all 4 of the incorrect ones. Okay, let's go to the answer choices. What does the argument do? Does the argument equate the quality of care at a hospital? Okay, quality of care. I guess it mentions quality of care. Equate the quality of care at a hospital with patients' average length of stay. Well, it says the right buzzwords, right? Ooh, okay, average length of stay, quality of care. Does it equate them? Actually, the author says if you decrease the average length of stay, you affect the quality. What? You don't affect the quality? That means that's wrong, right? It says if you decrease the average length of stay, you might not affect the quality. And so it doesn't equate it. In fact, it does the opposite. It says that you can decrease one without decreasing the other. So we know that this is wrong, right?
Yeah.
All good? Okay, good. B. So does it treat a condition that will ensure... Okay, so does it treat a condition that will... Okay, so are there any conditions here? I don't see a condition. So the argument doesn't treat any conditions. So if I'm in a rush, I would immediately cross this off as wrong. But let's look a little bit more. Treat a condition that will ensure the preservation of quality of care, okay, that's the buzzword that's written there, as a condition that is required to preserve quality of care. Okay, so it's saying, you're saying one thing is sufficient when one thing, you know, is required, or one thing is required when one thing is sufficient. This is a typical LSAT answer choice. However, firstly, there are no sufficient or necessary conditions mentioned in any of this. We're talking about averages and lengths of stay, not this is required for that to happen. So, bang, that's wrong. That's a time trap. It can take you a long time, eat up your time in answering the question, because you're looking for conditions and what might be required or sufficient. Be careful of time traps. Okay. C. This is why you might like skip this answer straight, like right after when you see that there are no conditions. C. Okay. Fails to take into account the possibility, okay, does it fail to take, I mean, could, there's a lot of possibilities it fails to take into account. Okay, so step one passed. The patients at Edgewater Hospital tend to be treated for different illnesses. Okay, well, yeah, it's possible that you have this kind of skew where you have some people staying for 2 days and 6 days, and then all people staying for 6 days. Because this is their actual recovery time. Or even that you have a new one where it's possible that the average is higher because they have the same 2-6 as Edgewater, but then they have like a patient with terminal anus cancer that will need 100 days to recover, right? So I guess it's terminal, they're not going to recover at all, but let's just say that it would take, they'd have to spend 100 days there, right? So, this would actually explain this, and if this was the case, okay, let's have a look. Patients at Edgewater tend to be treated for different illnesses than patients at University Hospital. Okay, if they tend to be treated for different illnesses, then it would affect the recovery time. So, And they don't mention that. So that actually looks pretty good. You know, if there are different illnesses being treated, then you really can't boot someone out 2 days early to say that, but just because you think that they're both the same and they're staying longer than their recovery time needs, you need to think, well, perhaps there's more recovery time needed. Perhaps there's more recovery time needed because the illnesses are different. This guy's got anus cancer. You can't kick him out after 2 days. Oh, shit. Alright. I'm gonna need to stay in the hospital now. Okay, so 2 days. Yeah, don't kick me out early. Alright, let's have a look at D. We won't accept that answer choice yet because we haven't excluded the other two. Okay, so maybe the other two are better. D. Presumes without, okay, does the argument presume without providing justification that the length of time patients stay in the hospital is never relevant? Okay, never relevant? Okay, to the recovery rates of these patients. Okay, so anytime the LSAT says never, must, always, that's a red flag, so circle or underline that word if it's especially important because usually that's very, very strong answer choice and possibly wrong. Okay, so it presumes without providing justification that the length of time patients stay in the hospital is never relevant to the recovery rates of these patients. So they're saying the length of time the patient stays and the recovery rates are completely unrelated to each other. Well, no. Like, what's the whole point of a hospital if that's the case, right? They even say that, you know, recovery rates are somewhat important to deciding how long you stay, so this is completely wrong. They don't presume that the length of time and the recovery rates are never relevant. Maybe they'll presume that they're sometimes not relevant, or that they sometimes are different. But that's not the same as saying they're never relevant. If you say they're never relevant, that's extreme. And that's completely wrong. So, bang. The argument writer does not presume that the length of stay and recovery rate are never relevant to each other. And that would be ridiculous to assume that. Okay, E. Does the argument fail to take into account, okay, fails to take a lot of things into account, fail to take into account the possibility, that patients at the university hospital generally prefer longer hospital stays? Okay. Well, it doesn't take that into account, so, but why would it take that into account? It's not relevant. Is failing to take that into account a flaw in the argument? I don't think anyone would need to take into account what the patients prefer. Maybe they prefer to stay a million days, but it's not relevant, right? Even if you put this as a premise in the argument, you know, two hospitals similar for patients with similar illnesses, plus patients at university hospital prefer longer hospital stays. Therefore, university hospital could decrease its average length of stay without affecting quality of care. Well, it's very weak. In fact, if it could be even wrong if you say that them preferring longer hospital stays, it's not relevant to the argument. It does even if they did take it into account, it wouldn't strengthen it. It would actually probably weaken it a little. And if because they didn't take it into account, it doesn't make the argument weaker. It's not really that relevant to the argument. So while this is true, they didn't take it into account, it's not a weakness. It's not a flaw in the argument. So we not if we keep remembering that this is a flaw question, we can safely exclude that because taking it into account or not taking it into account doesn't change the flaw, like how flawed the conclusion is. But failing to take this in C into account really does because you know, they're not looking at the illnesses and the actual recovery times. You know, booting out this person 2 days earlier means they don't get any treatment at all, right? So it would affect the quality of care. This kind of thing. So basically, now that we've excluded these four, this is very strong and it was strong before anyway, so that's our answer.
Thank
Sounds
you.
pretty straightforward, right?
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Thank you.